Hi, I'm Wilco Noman, and I would like to share a quick thought regarding our perspective about money. Like I previously mentioned, your finances can be seen as a bucket, and the water inside your bucket is your money. And I found that one of the leaks in my bucket was my perspective toward it was not correct. You know, I regarded people as rich because they had more than me. And I found out that riches can be deceiving. Wealth is relative to your perspective. And a big lesson that I learned was that the wrong perspective creates big holes in my financial bucket. Let me give you an example of how my emotions was connected to my financial well-being. One day I sat depressed in front of my computer screen and realized that my happiness was connected to the digit on my computer screen. Money goes in and out of our bank account, and as soon as there's a minus in front of the amount, you get depressed. The difference between happiness and concern is a small stripe on the computer screen in front of me. A plus is good, a minus assaults my faith. The amount on the computer screen will determine how I work with people that day. Isn't it ridiculous? That stripe determines whether I'm going to sleep tonight. Unfortunately, it's the truth that there was a time that I linked God's goodness to my bank balance. I thought that if there is a lot of money, God is good. But in contrast, if my bank account is empty, it means God has forsaken me. With my mouth, I confessed God is my shepherd and that I shall not want for anything. But in reality, I put my trust, my hope, my happiness, my well-being, and my emotional state in the plus or the minus. It's only later that I came to realize that true wealth has nothing to do with how your bank account looks. In the book I write, I talk about your perspective about money. And the first question I try to answer is, what is enough? The world measures wealth differently than God. According to the world, wealth lies in the abundance of possessions. Therefore, although we have many possessions, we still feel poor because someone else has more than us. Wealth is relative. People feel rich or poor depending on who looks at them and from what angle. If they have more than me, they are rich. If they have less than me, they are poor. Not only is wealth relative, but wealth is also deceptive. There's a website where you can go to and it determines your wealth ranking in the world. You enter your annual salary and it will tell you in what percentage you fall. The website's name is globalrichlist.com. Now, I went ahead and I added 10,000 Rand per month as an income, and according to this website, you fall under the top 2.82% richest people in the world if your monthly income is only 10,000 Rand. I also went ahead and I added 20,000 Rand per month to see where you fall. Now, as I write here, 20,000 Rand a month will enable you to live in a decent suburb. You will have running hot water. You'll be able to afford electricity, non-leaking roof, clothes, and quite probably a vehicle, as well as the opportunity to buy some groceries. Now, if you earn 20,000 Rand per month, you fall under the top 0.44% of the richest people in the world. But yet, you still feel poor because you drive a Polo and your neighbor drives a BMW. You see, our perspective of wealth in this world is perverse. And when I say you and us and our, I'm not talking about everyone, because I know there's a lot of people out there that do know how to work with money. I'm merely referring to the big majority of the population that has been to school and that has never received one word on how to work with money in God's way. Right, riches are deceitful. The deceitfulness of riches associates joy with stuff. People think the more things I have, the happier I will be. And the reason that I'm not happy is because I do not have enough things. So this is a very profound statement that I learned. If the enemy cannot take away what God has given you, he will devalue it in your eyes so that you won't appreciate it anymore. You begin to consider it worthless. You start finding fault. You see something different and something better, whether it's your vehicle, your job, your spouse, your home, your circumstances, even yourself. You want everything different from what you already have and who you are. That's the deceitfulness of riches. So Jesus warned us about this deceitfulness of riches. In Luke, he talks about the parable of the sower who sowed the seed and the thorns that grew up and choked it. If we are not careful, our perspective regarding wealth will choke our finances. The second question regarding your perspective about money is, what is your definition of success? Is it lots of money, a big income, new furniture, luxury vehicles, lots of assets, and a life without problems? But here's the truth, a man with a lot of money but without love, little peace and no joy, is a poor man. In the Bible, I read a lot about the importance of what's happening in your heart. What I don't see as much is what is happening in your bank account and on your income statement. Proverbs 4:23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life. It's important that we get a good perspective on success. Because if we see success as an abundance of possessions, we are in for a big surprise. The third perspective principle that I write about, and the question that I ask, is what do you regard an asset? Now, per definition, an asset is described as something useful or valuable. If you define an asset in terms of monetary value, you will consider yourself poor if you don't have financial assets. If you are privileged to have two working eyes, my question to you is, would you accept R1 million today for your eyes? Maybe that's not enough. What about 5 million? If I would offer you R5 million for your two working eyes today, would you accept it? Any person in his right mind would not accept that offer. Now, suddenly your assets are significantly more than what you thought. You see, we own assets that cannot be listed on our balance sheets, and mistakenly we think we are poor. If you have the wrong perspective regarding money, you will overlook your assets. We are rich, we are blessed, but we cannot see it because our perspective is clouded by the deceitfulness of riches. The fourth principle that I want to mention, and this is one that I deal with on almost a daily basis in my business consulting and financial coaching, is that we as humans tend to compare our lifestyles with that of another. We call it keeping up with the Joneses. Here's the irony. The Bible says, do not try to look like the world. In fact, Romans 12:2 says that, and be not conformed to this world. There's another scripture in John says, we are in this world, but we are not of this world. In other words, we are not called to look, to speak, and to live like this world. We, as children of God, are supposed to look different than the world. If you have the wrong perspective and you are playing this game of keeping up with the Joneses, there's a scripture that speaks to you. 2 Corinthians 10:12 says, but when they measure themselves by one another and compare themselves with one another, they are without understanding. It's very important to have biblical perspective about money. The fifth perspective about money is to practice contentment. The Bible says we seem to have nothing, yet we really possess everything. 2 Corinthians 16. Contentment breaks the power of greed, the desire for more and more. It also assists against the unquenchable thirst for something else. The Bible says that, but if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. 1 Timothy 6:8. And I'm not saying that having nice things is wrong. I'm merely saying that we have to have a healthy perspective on money, a biblical perspective. Now, even the Apostle Paul struggled with contentment. If you read Philippians 4:11, it says, I am not saying this because I feel neglected, for I have learned to be satisfied with what I have. Paul wrote that he had to learn contentment, or to be satisfied, meaning it did not come naturally. Wanting more and wanting better, unfortunately, is a human trait. So being content won't come naturally. It's a spiritual discipline that we need to learn. It is possible to be content with what you have, with where you are, and who you are. Jesus himself said that, watch out, guard yourselves from every kind of greed, because your true life is not made up of the things you own, no matter how rich you may be. That's Luke 12:15. Trust also plays a big role in contentment. We need to trust God that he can and he will supply in his children's needs. Remember, if you are not satisfied with what you have, you will not be satisfied with what you want. One of the best ways to practice contentment is to count your blessings. Literally, to sit down and start a gratitude list. List everything that you are grateful for and start with your eyes. Gratitude does something inside of you. It makes you content and allows you to forget about what you think you need. Gratefulness brings things into the right perspective. I want to encourage you that this is a spiritual discipline that not only will help you with the right perspective regarding money, but it will also serve you the rest of your life. That brings me to the end of this message. I'm Wilco Nauman, business consultant and author. Till next time.